morning. We welcome you here to the Canton United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Clay. It's a delight to be together as the family of God, have gathered together here to rejoice in the truth of our faith that Jesus is with us as we gather in his name this morning. As we come into worship this morning, I just want to invite us into the service. We're going to be continuing our message series. We're walking through the story of some of the characters from the Bible that were impacted most by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Last week, we talked about doubting Thomas and talked about how that story isn't so much about doubt as it is about God's faithfulness, because through God's faithfulness, Jesus was able to give Thomas what he needed in order to be brought to deeper faith. And this morning, we're going to be looking at the story of Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene is one that followed Jesus with all of her life and throughout all of her life, and it's because Jesus had healed her from so much, and Jesus had changed her, and just that lifelong faithfulness that came out of this story. Even though everything changed for Mary Magdalene, was she afraid that things were going to change again? No, because the faithfulness of Jesus was just that strong in her life. Jesus gave her a second chance, and it's a second chance that never really went away. And Jesus gives us a second chance too. So with that on the forefront of our minds, let's begin to praise God through song this morning by singing along with our praise team.
All right, I won't make you stand a lot today, but this first song is a new hallelujah. So let's stand together and let's sing this song with all our might. Children are free. know this song, so.
Would you join me in a moment of congregational prayer? Will be the prayer on the screen for you this morning. Together we pray. God of the resurrection, we thank you for the new life you have given Jesus and all who follow him. Through the power of your Spirit, inspire us to make a leap of faith into your loving arms. May we believe the words of Scripture when they speak of your victory over death, And may we accept the promises you make of the future. We praise you for your love, your joy, and your wonderful living hope. Hope that points us to the future that we cannot see, but that we believe you will guide us through. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm just so glad that I serve a God who gives a second, third, fourth, and 156 chances for everything that I do wrong. And all we need to do is just come to Him and ask for forgiveness.
I am guilty, ashamed of what I've done, what I become. These hands are dirty. I dare not lift them up to the Holy One.
Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. give you thanks for the beauty of creation and the agency that you've given for us to enjoy it. We give you thanks for just the reality of you being a part of our lives and you being an integral part of our lives. We give you thanks for the way that you instill hope in the midst of hopeless situations, peace among in turmoil, order in chaos, and joy amid sadness. God, on this day where we focus on Mary Magdalene, we are just drawn to your grace. For everything that grace means to us, the way that grace moves and works and transforms our lives. We give you thanks for the way that grace has been made known to us throughout the history of your interaction with humanity, throughout the life of Jesus, and the ways that your people have extended grace to us, inspired by the gracious acts of Jesus Christ. God, it is pure grace that we are able to approach you, because we do fall short. We do mess up. We do find ourselves in need of a do-over. And you meet us. And you provide. And you hear us when we cry out to you, as we have done this morning, as we've mentioned things that concern us, health concerns, upcoming procedures, scary situations in fire departments. God, you meet us in our joy as we celebrate new opportunities, successes, safety, and love. God, we just give you thanks that you are with us in the midst of all of life, that you invite us into these moments of prayer. And when we do not have words figured out, when we can't come up with anything, you've even provided for us then, as you gave your disciples through Jesus a model of prayer and instructed all of us to cry out to you and say these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I want to invite our kids forward for a time that's mostly just for them. Good morning, team. How's it going this morning? Good, 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 good. So, I have grabbed the treat basket, and I want you to know that the treat basket is here. How does it feel to know that the treat basket's here today? You want to eat it? It feels good? Yeah? What if I told you that the treat basket was only going to be here for today and it was never going to come back ever again, ever? How would you feel? You would go take it. What if I threw it in the trash can? You would take it out. You're a very resourceful little thinker there, Sophia. I appreciate you. Yeah. Would we be kind of upset if I took the treat basket away? Yeah. Would we be a little sad I took the treat basket away? Yeah. Do we kind of depend on the treat basket? That doesn't really move a whole lot, does it? It's usually just there, right? Yeah, it's a pretty cool basket that we have here. It's a pretty handy basket that we have here, yeah. So today, we're going to be talking about a woman named Mary Magdalene. And Mary Magdalene found Jesus in her life, and Jesus changed everything for her, and it was really, really, really exciting because her life was not going very well. It was a really sad time for her in life, and Jesus made everything better. But then what happened to Jesus? He died, right? Yeah, Jesus went away.
What was the sad thing?
The sad thing is that Jesus died, Wouldn't you be kind of sad if Jesus made this big difference in your life and then Jesus just died out of nowhere? Yeah, that'd be pretty sad, right? It would almost be as traumatic as taking away the treat basket. I'm saying. Yeah. It would be pretty sad. It would be, I agree. But the good news in Mary Magdalene's story is that Jesus shows back up. When does Jesus show back up for Mary Magdalene? Easter morning on the day called Resurrection. On the day of the Resurrection, Mary Magdalene shows back, or Jesus shows back up. And when Jesus meets Mary, she's crying by the tomb of Jesus because she doesn't know what's going on. She just knows that the tomb is empty and Jesus isn't there, and she's really, really afraid. But then Jesus shows up. And all of the bad things that happened to her in life are never going to happen again because Jesus is never going to not go away. Just like the treat basket isn't going to go away. I wouldn't do that to you, I promise. Yeah. So we can just hold on to the fact that even when life goes weird for us, Jesus still shows up for us and gives us what we need in order to just, you know, to believe in him. So we're going to say a prayer. I'm going to say a phrase and have it repeated after me, and then we'll have a treat after that. Dear Jesus, we thank you for the way that you show up for us. We thank you for your love that you promise will never leave us. We thank you for Mary Magdalene and the way that she shows us that your love is forever. Help us to always know of your love and care for us. We love you. We serve you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, you may calmly come and get a treat out of the treat basket and then head back down to your adults. Our scripture this morning comes to us from two different places. First, from the Gospel of Luke in chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, and then from the Gospel of John in chapter 20. But let's go ahead and hear this reading from Luke's Gospel. It is found on page 90 of your pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along with today's reading. It'll also be on the screen for you this morning. Sometime later, Jesus traveled through the towns and villages, preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. The 12 disciples went with him. And so did some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had been driven out. Joanna, whose husband Chauza was an officer in Herod's court. And Susanna, and many other women who used their own resources to help Jesus and his disciples. Let me jump forward in the story to John chapter 20 on the day of the resurrection on page 154 in your pew Bibles as we read from John chapter 20. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been taken away from the entrance. She went running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, whom Jesus loved, and told them, "They had taken Jesus from the tomb, and we do not know where they have put him." A little bit later, Mary stood crying outside of the tomb. While she was still crying, she bent over and looked into the tomb and saw 2 angels there, dressed in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been, one at the head and the other at the feet. "Woman, why are you crying?" they asked her. And she answered, "They have taken my Lord away, and I do not know where they put him." Then she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. "Woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. "Who is it that you are looking for?" She thought he was the gardener, and so she said to him, "If you have taken him away, sir, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and said in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. "Do not hold on to me," Jesus told her, "because I have not yet gone back up to the Father. But go to my brothers and tell them that I am returning to him who is my Father and their Father, my God and their God." And so Mary Magdalene went and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and related to them what he had told her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Holy and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be holy and acceptable to you. For you, O God, are our rock, and you are our Redeemer. And we give you thanks for who you are as we say together, Amen. The 1991 cinematic masterpiece, City Slickers, is in my top five favorite movies of all time for this very specific reason. City Slickers is one of the three VHS tapes that my Grandma Doris owned, and so when we went to Grandma Doris's house, it was one of the movies that my sister and I were allowed to watch. Nothing else is on, let's watch City Slickers. And so if you do not remember the movie in excruciating detail the way that I do, let's just be reminded that the plot centers around three lifelong friends. Mitch, played by Billy Crystal, Ed, played by Bruno Kirby, and Phil, who is played by Daniel Stern. And these three lifelong friends go on wild adventures to escape from their mundane lives. And so for Mitch's 39th birthday, the friends have gifted him a two-week cattle drive at a ranch in Colorado. They're going to ride out and ride back and bring these cattle into the ranch place. As you might expect for three people from New York City that have never really done anything in life, there are a lot of fish out of water hijinks, but all of the characters just have this time to process their life and what life is going to look like when they get back home. And what's so interesting about the movie is that all of the characters, even some of the side characters, all of the characters have these crystallizing epiphanies of how they're about to change their lives after this vacation. And the pertinent one to what we're going to be talking about today is the life change that happens in the guy that Daniel Stern plays, Phil Berquist. Phil Berquist is a browbeaten person that is stuck in a job that is meaningless to him. He is a manager of a grocery store, which, by the way, is not a bad job, but there's just more to his situation. Phil is one that has been completely and utterly just demoralized by life. He is constantly belittled and insulted by his wife and his father-in-law. His father-in-law also happens to be his boss, by the way, making life just a little bit interesting. The long and the short of it is that life is not going his way. And in his estimation, things are never going to ever get better. And can we just name and own the fact that that just sounds dark and kind of heavy? This makes the character a little bit of a downer throughout the movie, but also because of, if you have the right sense of humor, it makes him a one-liner machine. Kind of my favorite character in the movie. But things start to turn around for Phil near the end of the movie as Billy Crystal's character Mitch reminds Phil of what would happen when they would play baseball as a kid and things would start to go awry. Mitch gets Phil's attention and says to him, "Do you remember when we were kids and we were playing ball and we would hit the ball over the fence and out of bounds and we would just yell do-over?" Then he says, "Your life is a do-over. You get a clean slate. Your life is a do-over." Now, if there were any person in Scripture who knew that her life was a do-over after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it is, in fact, Mary Magdalene. And what I find so interesting is that her do-over goes so far back even to her very identity. Because the problem for Mary Magdalene is that there are so many women in Jesus' life that are named Mary that we could do our own sermon series called Oops, All Marys and have several weeks of stories to tell. This has led to her identity getting confused and conflated. And so before we dig into the change that has happened in her life, it's important for us to know which Mary is Mary Magdalene. The problem started all the way back in the 6th century when Pope Gregory I misidentified her in a sermon, and it just led to the tradition and the legend of Mary's identity growing. There are some that have put forward that Mary Magdalene is the woman at the well that talks to Jesus in John chapter 4. or that Mary Magdalene is the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8, or even that Mary Magdalene is the unnamed woman that we would have read about if we read Luke 7 before we read Luke 8 this morning. And all of this took until 1969 to fix, when at the Second Vatican Council she became known as Mary Magdalene, Saint Mary Magdalene. And she became known for who she truly was, which is the first person to see the risen Jesus. All that we really know about who Mary Magdalene is what we know from Scripture, from what we read at the start of Luke's gospel, where he says that Mary Magdalene, who is, you know, Mary who's called Magdalene, was the one from whom seven demons were driven out. Outside of that, we don't actually know Mary's life before Jesus. Everything that we say about her is nothing more than conjecture. We just know that she was possessed by demons. We do not know the depth of her physical pain. We do not know the level of mental turmoil, and we do not know how consuming this possession may have been. But we know from other people that are described in the Bible as demon-possessed that life would not have been very fun. Life would have been horrible, in fact. She would have been one who was in desperate need of a do-over. And so imagine how much relief Mary Magdalene would have experienced in being healed. Imagine what would have happened in her life as she is given a do-over in real time and all of her ailments are just taken away. Imagine the level of connection that she would have to Jesus. Imagine the depth of devotion she would have to Jesus. Mary Magdalene is among the women who become an integral part of Jesus' ministry. And whatever happened in her life before Jesus doesn't matter nearly as much because it is all simply left behind. But then Jesus dies on the cross. And I want you to imagine the turmoil that she may have experienced when the source of her healing was taken away from her. And imagine the mental anguish that would have grown in the following days when Jesus seemed like he was going to simply stay dead. And then on the morning of the resurrection, imagine her frustration at not being able to complete a task that felt like the least she could do for someone who did so much for her and for others. Mary Magdalene knew darkness before Jesus. Mary Magdalene knew darkness after Jesus. And perhaps on that Easter morning, she was starting to think that she would once again know darkness. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that Jesus will not allow any of us to stay in our darkness, especially not a woman who gave up everything to follow Jesus. When we meet Mary in John's gospel, we are told that Mary is weeping by the tomb of Jesus, and it's not hard to understand why. But those tears will not last as someone engages her in conversation. And after Jesus says her name, she realizes that the darkness of her life is not coming back. Jesus is the one who is coming back. Mary realizes that it is, as John said in the gospel to begin with, that the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never put it out. And as Jesus commissions her to go and tell the disciples this news that she has experienced, that her life is totally transformed once again, and her identity is secured. No matter how else we identify Mary Magdalene, we have to identify her as the first follower of Jesus to see the risen Lord. as the first messenger of hope and good news of the resurrection. As the first Christian minister, as she went and cared for the disciples by telling them the good news that Jesus was alive. Jesus took Mary Magdalene from being a demon-possessed woman to a devoted follower. And from a devoted follower to an active proclaimer. And after far too long, Vatican II called her who she truly is, which is a saint of the church. Can we talk about the do-over that happened in her life? Can we talk about the do-over that happened over and over and over again in her life? But I want you to know that do-overs are not reserved for firsthand witnesses to the resurrection. And do-overs are not reserved for people that feel like life has gone too far out of the window, that there's no possible way back. Do-overs are for you. And do-overs are for me. And do-overs are for anyone who realizes that Jesus can make this much of a difference in someone's life. Friends, I don't fully know how it is that you've come here today. I don't fully know what darkness you have faced in your life or what darkness feels like is waiting for you when you leave this place this morning. What I know is this. I know that your life is a do-over. Your life is a do-over. You get a clean slate. And whether that do-over started 75 years ago or whether that do-over started in the last few seconds since I said those words, it is because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ that your life and mine is a do-over. There is no darkness too thick, no burden too heavy, no stronghold too robust, no life circumstance too complicated that it cannot be overcome by the power of the resurrection. Sometimes we need a do-over. And sometimes, if we're being honest, we need a do-do-do-over. The resurrection offers all of it. And we don't even have to go on a two-week cattle drive to find it. All we have to do is to believe and to follow and then to share the news with someone else that needs a do-over too. Would you pray with me? Loving Jesus, we give you thanks for the way that you offer a do-over to us. We give you thanks for the things in life that go well and where we don't think we need a do-over, but we also give you thanks for the way that you meet us in the midst of disaster and offer us the do-over that we so deeply need. Help us to experience your grace today and help us to be like Mary, those that are called and sent to proclaim do-overs to the world around us. In your name we pray. Amen. This time I'm going to invite Bella to bring her family forward as we celebrate the joy of a baptism. Yeah, I'll have you guys come right up here. We'll make kind of a line that way. Yep. Yep. Here's a copy of what we're going to be doing, the baptism here. Yep. All right. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, and we are given new birth by water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift offered to us without price. Let us remember that it is Jesus who said, "Let the children come to me and do not stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Therefore, it is my honor to present Bella Kay for baptism this day. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, pour out your Holy Spirit upon this gift of water. Bless this gift and those who receive it to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, Almighty God, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Parents and sponsors, I have some questions for you, but don't worry because I also have the answers for you. So let's go ahead and encounter these questions together. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? If so, answer, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, answer, I do. Will you nurture Bella in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and lead a Christian life? If so, answer, I will. Sydney and Jeffrey, will you support and encourage Bella in her Christian life? If so, answer, I will. Do you, as Christ's body of the church, reaffirm your rejection of sin, your acceptance of God's grace, and your commitment to Christ? If so, answer, we do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian life and faith and include Bella now before you in your care? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Bella with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her trust of God and be found faithful in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. All right. Can you come see me? Can you come see me for just a sec? All right. I know I'm strange. I know, I get it. Yeah. There's a lot of people out there. There's a lot of people that already love you. That's pretty cool. Yeah. What name is given to this child?
Bella K. Morales Sosa.
Bella K. I baptize you in the name of the God who created you, of your Savior Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit that shall guide you all the days of your life. Bella, may the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Are you good if I take her for a little walkabout?
Yeah.
All right. We're going to go see some people. Yeah. Oh. Good morning. Can you say good morning? No, I'm not into this, Pastor Clay. Knock it off. Friends, when we do a baptism, it's a communal activity. It's an activity of the entire church. Luis and Cassidy have made promises. Jeffrey and Sydney have made promises, and we have made promises on behalf of this child to be a part of raising her in the faith, raising her so that she lives a Christian life, engaging in ministries of the church and outside of the church, all designed to help her be a true disciple of Christ. I know, I'm still kind of weird looking. I understand it. So I bring her down here just as a reminder of the promises that we have made. All right, we'll get you back to familiar territory. You did so great.
There's no crying.
Yeah. Would you join me in this welcome on the screen? Dear friends, now it is our joy to welcome our sister in Christ. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the family of Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend Bella Kay to your love and care. Dwell in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
We have a few signs and reminders of this day that I'll present to you at this time. We have a candle. I just want to invite you to burn on the date of the anniversary of her baptism as a reminder of the way that the light of Christ shines brighter because of Bella's membership in the kingdom of God. We have a baptismal certificate to signify this day. We also have certificates for you as sponsors as a reminder of your role in Bella's life going forward. And now may the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Jesus Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. Now let us welcome our newest member of the body of Christ.
Thank you.
but you rose. All of heaven held its breath till the stone was moved for good, and the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tomb, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all have come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame, and the gospel truth of old shall not heal, shall not fade.
Let us stand together as we receive this benediction. Friends in Christ, go from this place knowing that the risen Christ goes ahead of you. There is no one you will encounter, no circumstance you will face, no event that will occur that is beyond the redemptive reach of our risen Lord. Jesus is already there, at work, drawing the world to himself. In that power, you are sent to go forth and be messengers of his grace and his love. And all God's people said, amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord this week.
Have a great week.